you'll be seeing the Holmes-Cooney fight in its entirety. But you'll be seeing it with a whole new twist. Because of the scoring controversy that evolved after the fight, we're going to have that fight scored for you after each and every round by the three judges involved, Ford, Moretti, and Roth. And each judge will explain why he scored each round the way he did. Then, as emphasized earlier, after the fight, you will meet the two judges, Ford and Moretti, who became involved mostly in the scoring controversy. You'll also meet the referee, Mills Lane. We'll hit each and every issue involved in the fight. And finally, the two fighters, Holmes and Cooney, reflecting back to the night of June 11th. So let's go back to that night and the scene set for the fight itself, as I called it, at that very time.
Now about 32,000 of them ready to explode with anticipatory tension. And there is the theme song from Rocky, the very music requested by the challenger, Jerry Cooney. And here comes the challenger, and the crowd begins to roar as it is noticed that he is coming down the aisle toward the ring itself, flanked by security men, led by his trainer, Victor Valley. And behind him, his managers, Ike Jones and Dennis Rappaport. Huge man, devastating punch, but coming down this aisle, unspoken, a stream of consciousness. How will it be when I come out? Forget the clowning in the dressing room. Now the reality is here, and the crowd speaks for itself. Awaits the champion, Larry Holmes. And Holmes, with his entourage, virtually running down the aisle toward the ring. The music, ain't no stopping us now, requested by Larry Holmes. So much on his mind before this fight. At war with the media people, believes that they are the ones who have introduced ugly undertones of racism during the prelude to this bout itself. Holmes approaching the ring, his people coming in, a lot of wisdom in his corner. Eddie Fudge, Ray Arcel, limbering up, look at his face. He's been waiting for this moment for a long time, but no different from Cooney. How will it be when he comes out? And there is Cooney. And the laughter and the clowning have disappeared. Each man now getting ready. The fight at hand.
The heavyweight championship of the world. Introducing, in the red corner, fighting from Easton, Pennsylvania, weighing 212 and one-half pounds, the undefeated WBC heavyweight champion of the world, the Easton Assassin, Larry Holmes. And in the blue corner, fighting out of Huntington, New York, weighing 225 and one half pounds. He is undefeated in his professional career. He is ranked number one by both the WBA and the WBC. Introducing, gentlemen, Jerry Cooney. 15 rounds of boxing.
So the fighters have been introduced. Cooney, a huge favorite out here. It must be noted in perfect frankness that some ugliness has surrounded
the anger between the two men, and both men are right. The ugliness relates to bringing in the issue of racism and the great white hope. As Cooney said, we're Americans. No, Cooney will not now look at him. He will look down. Good fight. Cooney did not look at it. No. Mills Lane, so tiny between them. Mills Lane, a good, confident, experienced referee. But how can a man that size contain the two huge men who are the fighters? How can he use the physical control that may be necessary? The bout begins. Quickly seeking movement, flicking the left in. I'm a boxer, he says, and that's what I'm going to do. Cooney, much better defensive fighter than given credit for. Again, the left sneaks in. But always the need to be careful. The midsection. Thunderous power in Cooney. You have to respect it. We're just coming up to the minute mark in the first round. 1 minute of action. Target. Cooney has not faced any. Not Young, not Lyle, not Kenny Norton. Minute and a half gone in the round. Cooney stalking. Nothing graceful about Jerry. Never had to be. Concentration in his eyes. Totally intent. Cooney with a slightly low blow. Unintentional. And Holmes spun him around. Cooney with his first pair of jabs. You see that right of Cooney's? It landed on Holmes' arm. He can deaden a fighter's arm. In the manner of Rocky Marciano, the late Rocky. Rolling the stars that couldn't lift his arms. They were black and blue for Marciano's blows. Counting down toward the end of round one. Again, that blow. A touch low. Holmes answering back with the left. The end of the round.
Scored the first round, Cooney 10-9. I felt that the round was rather even. However, Cooney landed the harder and more effective punches.
I scored round one 10-9 Cooney based on his more effective punches.
I scored the first round for Larry Holmes. I thought he landed numerous effective jabs and a good two or three punches towards the end of the round.
Crowd in the background. Now it's all bursting forth. You can see they look at the huge Cooney. Unafraid, coming toward the experience. Solidly professional champion. Let's listen to Cooney's call.
Get that defense. This guy's... I'm going to tell you.
Give a little sip of water.
Cool. Relax.
Little sip, Jerry.
Wild, don't go wild with him. Just take your goddamn time. Black. This is...
All right.
Nice and cool. Just think
what you're doing.
Victor Valley, the trainer, himself, very excited, some profanity. But the basic lesson to Cooney, keep cool. Keep cool. And then he demeans Holmes' prowess as an opponent, Victor Valley. Should be telltale for Holmes, because that's when his boxing skills should be able to take over. I am just told that this is the hottest day of the year in Las Vegas. Now, right now at ringside, we are at 92 degrees, but with the lights up, it has to be over 100 in that ring. Thus the importance of stamina if this fight goes on. Minute 40 left in round two. Left shoulder, which caused the postponement, subjected to a series of stress tests 2 days ago, held up perfectly. Stalking, Holmes dancing, lots of movement. A good blow by Holmes, a good right. And it's called a knockdown. It is called a knockdown. Holmes scored with the right, and Cooney went down. The first knockdown of the fight. But the knockdown by Holmes, not by Jerry Cooney. The right caught him. But Cooney put him off balance, and down he went. Cooney opened for that right. He had blocked the left, brought it down, left himself open for the right. You could see he was stunned. He struggled to regain his balance, but he went down. All right, another angle. The right getting in cleanly. The left he had held. The right went down. Cooney's right went down. He dropped it after Holmes had his left blocked by that right. Still another replay. But notice, Cooney's left was not positioned properly for defense, because the left was at the side of his face, not in front of it. And Holmes could get right through to it.
He scored the second round 10-8 for Holmes. He was losing the round just prior to the knockdown. However, with the knockdown and the effective punching after, I scored the two-point round 10-8 for Holmes.
I scored the second round 10-8, Larry Holmes. Because of the knockdown and his jabs.
I scored the second round for Larry Holmes, 10-8. Very effective jabs plus strong right hand knockdown.
For round three, this crowd is still stunned itself by the suddenness with which Cooney went down. Has to be
wary about is the same thing that Sugar Ray Leonard had to be wary about against Tommy Hearns. Sugar Ray sitting right down the aisle from me. And that is, be careful. Don't leave yourself open because you've got it. Leonard might have knocked Hearns out in the sixth round, but he wouldn't chance. Hearns is right. Cooney was angered by being knocked down. He continues to stalk Holmes. Holmes continues to move, to use the whole ring. Floyd Patterson had an excellent analysis of this fight. He said, this fight depends on whether or not Cooney works the ring. Or rather, Holmes. Now Holmes fights the fight. Cooney trying to pull his way in there to land, to devastate Holmes with that enormous power. Remember, the best place for the left hook for Cooney is really the liver area, although it's pulverizing anyway. As Holmes continues to get that left jab in there, it does thwart and frustrate Cooney a little bit. Accumulatively, it will slow Cooney down if Holmes can continue successfully to execute. Less than a minute left of the third round. I don't know how this fight's going to turn out, obviously, but I have never seen Holmes so purposeful. Never.
Third round, I scored it 10-9 for Cooney. Holmes landed some hard punches early in the round. However, Cooney won the majority of the round.
Round three, I scored 10-9 Jerry Cooney. I felt that a lot of Larry Holmes' punches fell short, and it was clearly Cooney.
I scored the third round for Jerry Cooney. Very good round for him. He became aggressive, and he scored frequently.
Joe Frazier come out for the 15th round when Joe was all but blinded. The bell now. Round four. This is Holmes against Cooney. Holmes, boxer, fighting his fight thus far. One knockdown by Holmes in the second round. A right did it. And Holmes is using his right effectively. There is anger in Cooney. There is fire in him, too. And there is always the threat of that power. That's the left side, the liver area. Another left got in there. Remember, this fight is scored by three judges. No voice in the scoring by the referee. It's a 10-point must system of scoring per round. Three knockdown rule is in. It's waived now. This is championship fight. Correction. Mandatory 18.
Holmes continuing to use the jab. Holmes doubling with the left there. Hook. Not the jab. Round is beginning to connect with some of those blows to the body. Doubling on the left, coming in with a good right, then covering well as Holmes attempted to counterattack. Later in the round, this by Cooney. Watch for the right. There it was.
The fourth round, I scored a 10-9 for Cooney. Cooney hurt Holmes in this round. It was 10-9 round for Cooney.
I scored round four, 10-9. Jerry Cooney, I thought it was just clear that he won the round.
I scored the fourth round for Jerry Cooney. I thought he landed some very powerful punches to Larry Holmes' midsection, and again was more aggressive.
Double jab, double jab.
Double jab, double jab. And go to that body. You can see the confidence grow in Cooney in that fourth round. Test of such huge physical strength, not the skills and experience of Holmes. There are many who had the theory that the longer this fight went, the better it would be for Holmes. We'll find out about Cooney and the question of stamina. And we'll also find out, goes down, can he get up against a finisher like Cooney? And can he keep moving for 15 rounds as he verges on 33? These are the intangibles going into this fight that made it. Loom is fascinating. This is the fifth round. Jerry Cooney, beginning in the fourth round, began to make his fight. Has not been able to make Cooney go backwards, even though he did floor him in the second round. Minute 40 into round five. Yeah.
his right very well tonight. Uses his left to try again the right to Cooney. And Cooney made a remark to Holmes. I don't know exactly what it was, but he certainly is talking to Holmes now and not in a friendly way. Seconds left. Round five. One knockdown in the fight. Second round. Holmes knocked Cooney down. Did it with a right. Double. Double up, Valley told him, with the left jab, and that's what Cooney's doing. Now let's look in slow motion at that Larry Holmes right. There it was, and it connected cleanly, sharply, and it stung Jerry Cooney.
The fifth round, I scored 10-9 for Cooney. Cooney won 2 minutes of the round, about 30 seconds of it was even, and Holmes tried to rally about 30 seconds late in the round to try and steal it. I gave it 10-9 Cooney.
Round five, I scored 10-9 Larry Holmes. It was a close round, and I gave it to Larry on his two good rights.
I gave the fifth round to Larry Holmes. I thought he reasserted himself, had a strong finish, and won the round.
Round six underway. Holmes looking to establish the jab. Not easy when you're working against a taller man and must punch upward. Holmes with the flicking left jab, the lead, setting up the right. Again, the left gets in there. Jerry trying to use the left. That time picked off, that time too. The right. Right connected. Holmes laughing. But it's a false laugh, as it is with Cooney. Fear of failure haunts a fighter before he gets into the ring. All fighters, they'll tell you. Touch gloves, hit the right thing. He'll blame the referee. Of it, showing marked redness from the many Holmes lefts. Because they knew, they sensed the enormous power in his body. That right to the Holmes midriff was Cooney's best blow of the night. That right that he just threw was a beauty. A right. Victor Valley said to me, Jerry's right will be the dominating blow of the fight. He will astound Holmes with his right. Angie Dundee used to call Jerry a one-armed bandit, saying he can only fight with the left. Cooney getting it now from Holmes. For a moment, looked like Jerry might go down. Holmes is really laying it all over. Cooney is not in good shape. Suddenly, a Holmes attack. And Cooney fought out of it with a left as the round ended. tied a sixth round right here. Cooney going at Holmes, and then an apparently low blow, producing the first official warning from referee Mills Lane. Mills coming over now to stop the action momentarily, to tell Cooney to get those blows up. Then, later in the round, Holmes with a strong attack against Cooney. The legs suddenly wobbly. Cooney not with good balance as a fighter by any means. And Holmes pummeling Cooney this close to the end of the round. And then, as you have seen, Cooney somehow fought out of it. It appeared for the moment that he would go down, but he did not.
Sixth round, I scored a 10-9 for Holmes. Cooney won the largest portion of this round. However, Holmes landed 16 punches within the last minute that were severe. I scored it 10-9, Holmes.
Round six, I scored 10-9, Larry Holmes. I believe he won it in the last part of the round.
I scored the sixth round for Larry Holmes. I thought it was a very close round up to the finish, where I felt Holmes dominated.
Cooney has a cut. The left eye, bridge of the nose, is red as a beet. The left eye is cut. Holmes, after getting hit by Cooney's best blow, look at the cut, and it's still flowing blood. It's in the very corner of the left eye. It is an ugly gash. Holmes fought back from Cooney's right and really leveled Cooney with a bevy of blows. Cooney appeared ready to go down. He has gone down once. That was in the second round. Cooney being cautioned by Mills Lane that the blow was low to the stomach. Is laying a tattoo on Cooney's left eye, which is now swelling. Holmes has to be careful. The lightly regarded opponent is Ronaldo Snipes, and this, the very round, the seventh, almost put him away with a right. Holmes is moving much more flat-footedly now. He's not using the ring the way he was earlier. Let's see if he can go 15 if he has to. Now, average loss of title for heavyweights. Age, 30 and a half years for most of the heavyweights. Holmes verging on 33. And Holmes fighting beautifully. So far, always there lurks that Cooney power. Holmes said Cooney will go in seven. We have almost gone through the seven. Where Mills Lane has problems. At least he's been lucky not to have had real problems. Tonight he doesn't have the size to cope with those two huge men. Mills Lane cautioning on a low blow. Prediction did not take place. Now let's look at the two official warnings that were rendered in this round. You saw that low blow, Mills Lane stepping in now. Second warning of the fight officially to Jerry Cooney. Now watch again this later in the round, and that one clearly low. And again, third official warning by Mills Lane.
Seventh round, I scored a 10-9 for Holmes. Effective punches.
Round seven, I scored 10-9 Jerry Cooney. I thought his body shots were dominant. Larry Holmes did very little in this round.
I scored the seventh round for Jerry Cooney. I felt he became even more aggressive than in prior rounds and scored numerous effective body shots.
You're standing too straight. So you cannot stay straight. You gotta move in and rough this guy. You gotta move in. You gotta move in this guy and rough this guy. Don't let him jab from that side. He's staying too long. Now, you gotta move in on this guy. With your hand, get into a crouch.
Victor Valley imploring his fighter to change his style and tactics, to fight from a crouch, to keep moving in, to rough up the opponent, Larry Holmes. And let's see if Cooney will be able to do exactly what Valley is asking him to do. The eighth round. Which Cooney has never gone past. A round which Cooney has never had to go past. Per se, make stories, question his stamina. So somehow. Cooney is still the stalker. Far, Cooney has not sought to do what Victor Valley begged him to do. Now, as Cooney seeks to come back, drop, Holmes got in with the right again. Notice that Holmes is not using the ring the way he did earlier. Maybe the heat, maybe a growth in his confidence because of the way he floored Cooney in the second and almost knocked him down in the sixth, or whatever, he is not using the ring. Hey, Holmes was hurt for a second. Comes Cooney's mouthpiece, but he hurt Holmes. This is the eighth round, and this crowd is getting its money's worth. Cooney could sense that he had hurt him, but there's Holmes with the right. Yeah, he stands toe to toe with Cooney. Cooney blows, he's going to get cautioned on again. In slow motion in that eighth round, this effective combination, the left and right by Jerry Cooney, and the attempted counterattack by Holmes. Let's look at that same combination from a different angle. There's the left and there's the right. And then as Holmes counterattacked, out came Cooney's mouthpiece.
The eighth round, I scored 10-9 for Cooney. Cooney won the largest part of the round. However, late in the round, Holmes scored with a hard right and attempted to rally. However, it wasn't enough to win the round.
Round eight, I scored 10-9, Jerry Cooney. Larry Holmes came on late in the round, but I gave it to Cooney on effective punches thrown throughout the round.
I scored the eighth round for Larry Holmes. Again, he used his jab, coupled with a very strong right hand to win the round.
Turn around.
Indicate to judges at ringside a point deduction. First, temporary cessation of hostilities, then the point deduction. Then, this one, later in the round, and this was the one that caused Larry to double up in apparent pain. There could be no question about this one, and hostilities were halted.
The ninth round, I originally scored 10-9 for Cooney because I felt he was effective and landed more punches throughout the round. However, with the two-point deduction, Holmes ended up winning the round 9-8.
Round 9, I originally scored 10-9, Jerry Cooney. Cooney won the early part of the round. Larry Holmes came on, and then after the low blow, Cooney scored a few punches. But with a two-point deducted off of Jerry Cooney's score, the round ended 9-8, Larry Holmes.
I originally had the round 10-9 for Cooney. However, on the referee's instructions, I deducted the 2 points, which made it a 9-8 round. I felt Cooney's punching power was more effective than Larry Holmes in that round.
The heat is searing the crowd here. It has just been oppressive, impossible to measure how these fighters can continue to give their all this way. Cooney trying to clown a little bit, but may not be the time to do it. DeValley implored Cooney, you've got to do it now. What Holmes should do is be wary from his point of view, get back to that foot movement, not get overconfident and slug it out toe-to-toe, because Jerry Cooney has the power to finish Holmes at any time or anybody. What was it Joe Buckner said? Joe Frazier's left hook? It could hurt you, but Jerry Cooney's left hook goes right through you. No movement in Holmes in this round. If he's got the capacity for movement, he may be making a great mistake. We're a minute 20 seconds into the round. Round 10.
The 10th round, I scored at 10-9 for Cooney. Best round of the fight. I felt Cooney had the harder punches and the more effective inside. I ended up scoring at 10-9 for Cooney.
Round 10, I scored 10-9, Jerry Cooney. It was a close round, but I believe that the effective punches throughout the round by Cooney won the round.
I scored the 10th round for Jerry Cooney. I felt it was one of the better rounds of the fight, and I felt that his overall punching power dominated the round.
Profanity, Cooney to get rough, go Cooney's way. There'll be conjecture on whether or not that terribly low blow affected Cooney's stamina and ability to move. But that's conjecture. I mean, Holmes' stamina. That's conjecture. Still, the pursuer. Holmes to pursue. But the key, from Cooney's point of view, another low blow. He's taking another point away. It's happened too many times, according to Mills Lane. So Cooney already loses a point in this round. Cooney is not doing it intentionally. Not in my view. Two quick lefts by Holmes. This is the 11th round. Holmes looking to unload his right, knowing how vulnerable Cooney has been to it. Holmes staying in that corner. A mistake, but he's tired. Holmes is just plain tired. He years, maybe low blow, all coming together. Fighting. Kid, that's his skills, have overmatched. But who at any time could put him away.
Get off right, the right, the right. Drop him up. If they're going, if they're going to study, you're not studying. Stay low. Stay low. He gets up low. Low. He's coming in. Get off right.
Getting harder. Cooney just apologized. It's getting harder for Cooney to muster up comeback strength because both men have had to be suffering in this heat. Coming to the end of round 11. How many of you would have thought it would go this far? Good left by Cooney. Look at that third point deduction of the fight by referee Mills Lane. There you saw the low blow, and in comes Mills separating the fighters and motioning for the point deduction.
Round number 11, I originally scored at 10-9 for Holmes. It was all Holmes' round. However, with an additional 1 point deduction for low blow, the official score was 10-8 for Holmes.
Round 11, I originally scored 10-9 Holmes. His jabs and a very effective right gave him the round, and Cooney looked like he was getting tired, and with the point deducted, it made it a 10-8 round, Larry Holmes.
I originally scored round 11, 10-9 for Larry Holmes. I thought his punches were stronger, and I felt that Jerry Cooney's punching power was next to nil. However, the referee deducted one additional point, so the end result was a 10-8 round for Larry Holmes.
Getting ready now for round number 12. Mills Lane telling the Holmes corner to shut up over the complaints about the low blows. He said, I'm calling them. Blows. There once was a disqualification. Max Spelling won the title. Fourth round disqualification of the then champion Jack Sharkey. Low blow. Peyton Phil Scott made a career on alleged low blows. If you want to go back to the young 30s, I have no desire to. Notice the way this round started. Cooney backing up. Throughout the fight, he's been the pursuer. Round 12. To have a rematch. With Sugar Ray Leonard sidelined, maybe forever. This fight couldn't have come along at a better time from the point of view of the quote sport, unquote, of boxing. This is the 12th round. Oh, good. Pair of blows. Good three blows to the stomach of Holmes. Cooney in the late seconds. He's trying to muster up another charge. Larry without movement now. Flat-footed. The way Cooney would have liked to have seen him in the early going. Larry now trying to bounce, trying to move. It's a dangerous thing Holmes just did. He missed with a right, and his guard was down. So was his head. To the end of round 12.
Round 12, I scored at 10-9 for Holmes. A very effective round for Holmes. Did severe damage late in the round to Cooney.
The 12th round, I scored 10-9 Larry Holmes. Again, Cooney looked tired, and Larry hit him at will.
I scored the 12th round for Larry Holmes. I felt that Jerry Cooney's punching power was totally ineffective, and it was a clear-cut round for Holmes.
Ready for round 13, and I'll tell you. Before the start of the 13th round, that Angelo Dundee told Ray Leonard, "You're blowing it, kid. You're blowing it. You got to do it now." And Leonard was able to come on and do it. Cooney faces that problem right now.
Get up, first, get up.
Playing it careful. And Cooney still has that punch somewhere within him. Now these two men have stayed at this in this heat. Really. Unbelievable. Undefeated champion, an undefeated challenge.
Get down. On the bench. On the bench. On the bench.
That was the case when George Foreman beat Joe Frazier.
Get up. He's coming back. He's coming.
Sure, the man is tired. Wouldn't you be? A 20 by 20 ring. A heat of probably over 100 degrees. Both men huge. Drawing upon every resource. Physical, emotional, spiritual. The Holmes right again. Cooney still vulnerable to it. The left eye a mess. No other way to put it. only cautioned Holmes there. He was holding Cooney's gloves with his gloves, and he was right to caution, though he did not take the point away. Now it's getting a little sloppy because both men are tired, and Holmes trying to tee off and doesn't have the strength left. I don't think enough. Oh, Jerry's ready to go. There it is. Valley is calling it off. Let the scene speak. In Cooney's corner, understandably so. Reverend Jesse Jackson in Holmes' corner, exultant for Holmes' sake. And in slow motion, watch the Holmes right as the end was about to come. Holmes using his right brilliantly, purposefully, all night. He saw the uppercut come in there, and it was the beginning of the end for Jerry Cooney. See him falling against the ropes, beginning to go down. Hills Lane now picking up the count. And at this point in time, in came Victor Valley, with the same kind of protective emotion as we look at another angle that motivated Eddie Futch tonight in Holmes' corner, but on that night in Manila, refusing to let Frazier go out to take more punishment from Ali. Again, from this angle, the Holmes right. Now you saw in the opposite corner, Valley starting in. Holmes telling Mills Lane it's over, and then wrapping his arms protectively around the challenge. Still a third angle. And again, a quick glimpse of Valley coming in. And so this is the way it was here tonight in Las Vegas, Nevada. And now the announcement.
Ladies and gentlemen, the time, 2 minutes, 52 seconds of the 13th round. The winner, and still the WBC heavyweight champion of the world, Larry Holmes.
One vital point to be made: when Victor Valley went into that ring in the 13th round, under the Nevada State Athletic Commission rules, disqualification was automatic. It was not, as mistakenly reported by some media people, a technical knockout. Now, in terms of human drama, there is no substitute in life for spontaneity of reaction, which is why we now want to show you our exclusive interviews with Larry Holmes and Jerry Cooney in their dressing rooms just moments after the fight.
Really a remarkable fight, Larry. A tough one, but an utterly superb performance by you. My congratulations.
Thank you, Howard.
What do you think you proved in this fight, finally, to all the people?
I don't have to prove nothing to nobody. I never did. Just guys like you, Howard, that have the mic and have the last say, that keep saying that I'm not what Ollie used to be, or Joe Louis, or Joe Frazier, or George Foreman. So I don't want to be what those guys used to be. I just want to be Larry Holmes. All I want to do is love my family, fight for people. No colors involved, no money involved. Just the pride of having to be the heavyweight champion. The sport, that's what I enjoy. I enjoy people. And I'm sick and tired of everybody says, you have to prove something. You know, always taking the back seat. This is okay, because I don't have to take the back seat to my wife or my kids or to my family. I'm their champion. And if the people want to accept me outside, then I'm the people's champion. But if not, I have to live with myself and with my family, and that's all that really matters.
Okay, Larry. What's your evaluation of Cooney as a fighter?
Well, Jerry Cooney is very strong, very determined. I see a lot of good things with Jerry. I underestimated him, but he's a good fighter. He don't take a good shot yet, but he's a very good fighter, and he punches good. So he don't have anything to be ashamed of because he fought the baddest heavyweight in the world. So for Jerry Cooney, I say good fight, and I pray for you. Whatever your goals are, I wish you the best.
Jerry, difficult moment. You seem so depressed. You've got nothing to be ashamed of. You understand that, don't you?
Well, I want to say I'm sorry because I wanted to win very bad. And I've been away from home a long time. And I wanted to win for everybody that wanted me to win. And I guess what you call those are the breaks. So I want to get back to the gym. I'm going to train harder next time and fight a little more often. And get back and give this another shot and win next time. I'm sorry.
It is impossible, I think, to be with Jerry Cooney for any period of time and not grow to like him. He is big, amiable, and intelligent. But there was the issue of the low blows, about which I spoke with referee Mills Lane. Mills, having reviewed the fight and knowing the controversy that has ensued that contest, do you feel that you should have disqualified Jerry Cooney early on in the fight?
No, sir.
Why not? You began giving him warnings to keep the blows up as early as the second round.
True, but Rule 21 under the World Boxing Council rules provide a foul to the body will never be the end of the fight unless three things happen. One, the fouled fighter must request the disqualification. The doctor must certify that the fouled fighter cannot continue. And if the doctor so certifies, then the referee must at that point in time make a judgment of whether or not the fouls were flagrant and intentional and then call the fight. None of those things happened until the predicate was never laid to have the fight, to have the man disqualified.
When he struck Holmes with that palpably low blow in the ninth round, Mills, why didn't you consult the ringside doctor?
Here was my plan. Here's what I did. I sent Cooney to look for corner. I took Holmes to his corner. I said, Eddie, you got 5 minutes. You let me know at the end of 5 minutes if you want to continue, or I'll bring the doctor in. And you let me know any time before 5 minutes if you want to go on. In about 2.5 minutes, I said, Eddie, how do you stand? He said, how do we stand? And he said, I'm ready. So you ready to go? He said, yes, I'm ready to go. So the predicate was never laid to call the doctor in.
So much for referee Mills Lane. Next issue, the scoring by the two judges, Dwayne Ford and Dave Moretti, that evokes so much criticism and controversy after the fight. On that issue, my talks with the two of them. Dwayne, now you've had an opportunity to see and review the fight. You scored it 7 rounds Cooney, 5 rounds Holmes. After that review of the fight, would you still score it the same way?
I'd score it the same way, Howard. I don't believe that there's any rounds that I would possibly change, unless it'd be the seventh round. I scored that for Holmes. And in watching the tape now, Cooney might have had the edge. However, I had a different angle than what the camera had at that time. But I wouldn't have scored it any different.
As you know, Dwayne, there were a huge number of veteran boxing writers at that bout. And at ringside, overwhelmingly, they scored the fight. Overwhelmingly for Holmes. What is your personal reaction to that?
Oh, I'm aware of the hints. I'm aware of the blasting by the media. And I don't really think that it's justified. I don't think it was incompetent judging. It might be incompetent reporting.
Two direct charges the morning after the fight by the co-promoted Don King. One, he was mystified by the scoring. Two, the scoring was racially biased.
I resent the statement, Howard, personally. I've always been taught to judge a fight as though they're my two brothers in the ring. I didn't see a white fighter and a black fighter. I saw two gentlemen fighting and red gloves on them. And I had no prejudice going in. Larry Holmes, I've known. He's been a gentleman to me. I don't know Jerry Cooney. I had no prejudice of a white champion or any prejudice at all.
Who do you think landed the more effective punches?
Well, in certain rounds, obviously, I thought Cooney landed the more effective punches. They were hard body punches that scored well. And in some rounds, they weren't so effective. Mr. Holmes caught a few of them on his elbows and stuff. But I believe that he did do a pretty good job on Larry's body. I thought they scored, and they scored well.
Co-promoted Don King, in the press conference the morning after the fight, accused you and Judge Dwayne Ford of racial bias in your scoring, your rejoinder, if you will.
I agree with what Dwayne said. I didn't see any color in the ring. I've seen two gentlemen that were out there to show what they can do in the ring and try to win the world's championship. And that's all I seen. I had nothing against Mr. Holmes, Mr. Cooney, Mr. King, or anybody else. I just did the job that I thought I was out there to do. And I put my heart into it. I really did.
Then, in retrospect, no apologies from you on the manner in which you scored that fight.
This is the way I seen the fight, Howard.
Right.
And I review the fight again, and I still say that I would not change my score.
There remain, then, the fighters themselves, Larry Holmes and Jerry Cooney. And I'll be talking with Larry and Jerry in that order when I return in just one moment. Now, as you can see, the heavyweight champion of the world, Larry Holmes, and he's got some issue questions to meet squarely. First one, as you know, Sports Illustrated published some pictures purporting to show that you were guilty of foul tactics against Jerry Cooney. Your rejoinder.
I never fouled Jerry Cooney. What Sports Illustrated show is me pairing Jerry Cooney's punches on the side and measuring them up for my own punches. And those are the punches that they've taken pictures of.
Isn't it true that in both the 6th and the 13th rounds, referee Mills Alane cautioned you about laying your gloves on Cooney?
Yes, he did, because he'd seen what I was doing. I was setting Jerry Cooney up for the right hand, and he would caution me only when Jerry Cooney was hurt. Any other time, he did not caution me for anything. So he was doing that because I think he was protecting Jerry.
That's an open criticism of Mills Lane's refereeing. You wanted to state that.
Yeah, I did, because if you watch the film, and you'll be able to see it's evidence enough on film, he only interfered when Jerry Cooney was in trouble.
Your view now, reflectively, of the scoring, particularly of the two judges, Ford and Moretti.
Well, like I said before, I didn't care anything about the scoring. Only thing I cared about is winning. And now I'm going over it, seeing after the fact, don't guys have to be drunk to be scoring a fight like that?
The low blows situation. On Wide World, the day after the fight, in Cooney's presence, you said that the second blow in the 9th round had to be deliberate. Do you stand on that?
Yes, I do, because, you know, you can say maybe one or two or three, maybe even four, but 9 low blows, I mean, that's ridiculous, you know? And going over and hearing the rumors afterwards, Cooney was instructed to hit me low. All he wanted to do is get me out of there any way he can. So it was apparently that the low blow was intentionally.
You used the word rumor. You have no evidence that he was so instructed, do you?
No, I can go by what Dennis Rappaport said the night before the fight at a press conference. He would do anything he can to win the fight. If he had to kick me or hit me low, he would do that, because he was converting to Larry Holmes, using dirty tactics with the thumbing, mm-hmm. or whatnot, and that was just something that he wanted to be prepared to do in case they needed it.
The blood in your sneakers after the fight, what occasioned that?
Well, that come from the campus and the heat and the soft foam underneath and the movement, the lateral movement. And I wasn't able to stay up on my toes as long as I usually do because of my tearing of my feet and whatnot. Mm-hmm. But I done what I had to do. I'm still the heavyweight champion of the world.
Finally, will you give him a rematch?
Yes, I would. You know, I'm not afraid of Jerry Cooney. As a matter of fact, I feel that he'll be a much easier fight this time. But first, it will be no parity, and I will have to get $25 million to fight Jerry Cooney, and I will knock him out easier, faster.
Thank you very much.
You're quite welcome, Howard. You are a knockout. Thank you, ABC.
Jerry, Larry Holmes is charged that your co-manager, Dennis Rappaport, instructed you to hit him, Holmes, low blows. What's the answer?
The answer is that it's not true. I'm happy I'm with Dennis Rappaport and Michael Jones, and they're great managers, greatest that I know in boxing. And also with Victor Valle, got some criticism. And I love him too, and I think he did a great job. It was my own fault that I didn't listen in the corner.
The referee, Mills Lane, cautioned Larry Holmes in the 6th and 13th rounds for laying his gloves upon you. Did Holmes foul you?
Well, I think a couple of times that I did throw low blows, though, because he had grabbed me behind the neck and pulled me down, and the blows went low. Other times, you know, I mean, we could say anything now. It's not important. The outcome of the fight is over. I'm happy that I'm here and ready to get going again. And there's always room for Rocky too, right?
I suppose. I don't want to labor the point, but Holmes reiterated his charge that your blow in the 9th round was deliberately low. He said, Howard, once, twice, three, four times, but 9 times he hit me low. Your rejoinder.
Well, I don't think it was 9 times that we threw low blows, but however many blows they were all unintentional. And I was going to win that fight, not by being dirty, a dirty fighter. I've never fought that way before, and I don't want to ever start. So they were all accidental.
2 of the judges actually had you ahead in rounds, not in points because of the deductions, but in rounds, 7-5. What's your aftermath reflection about that scoring?
Well, I feel that I didn't fight my fight. Part of it was due to the ring rust, and the rest of it was hearing so much about going the distance that I kept holding myself back. And I think that the fight was close. I think I could have fought much, much better. But like I say, I mean, we can say anything when it's over. I just hope we get the opportunity to fight again.
What's your greatest regret, that you didn't follow the instructions of your corner?
My greatest regret is losing the fight and letting so many people down. Next time it will be different.
He says he wants $25 million, no parity, and that you must fight another fight first to reascend the challenge's climb. What's your reaction?
Well, as far as the money's concerned, that's not my part of, you know, my part is to get myself in shape and go and fight. I want to start fighting more often and becoming more active, so that there won't be any ring rust, and I don't have to hold myself back. I can just go ahead and fight my fight.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you, Howard.
Good luck to you.
Thank you.
So that's our show tonight, The Big Fight. June 11th was when it took place. Now you've got the whole story. Good night, all.
Right, which many of you may have just seen right here on ABC. Spencer Christian watched the fight with Jerry Cooney. They're out at Cooney's Pub out on the island. And now we're going to go live to Spencer and his guest, the heavyweight contender. Hello there.
Hello, Ernie. Things are jumping here at Cooney's East Side. And Jerry and I just finished watching the fight. And Jerry, we're going to play the last 30 seconds of the fight back, and we can watch it on our monitor here. And I want you to tell me how you felt at that time when Victor Valle jumped into the ring and said, that's it, you've had enough. What was going through your mind at that time? Did you feel you could continue?
Well, obviously, now I look back at it, I say I should have been ducking a little bit more, but the fight is over. I think the fight could have continued, but I love Victor and respect him for his opinion because he cared about me and thought enough about getting in and stopping the fight. So those are the breaks. And if I had to do it all over again, I'd do it much differently. So I hope I get the opportunity again. And then I'd like to say it's great being home in Long Island and being at Cooney's East Side.
I think that's apparent from the response you got from the crowd. What we're going to do is we're going to break away for a quick commercial break. When we come back, we're going to take a look at a couple more highlights of the fight and we'll get your analysis of what went on. We'll be right back. Back live at Cooney's East Side in Huntington, Long Island. Jerry, one of the big items that people talked about before the fight was your lack of experience. He said that was going to be a factor in the fight. And as we take a look at highlights of the sixth round when you were hurt and you were not able to cover up effectively, it appeared that that was one round where the inexperience showed. Is that the case?
Well, if you know, he thought he hurt me with a good shot. It was very important to me that I stay close to him. So I did cover up well. I stayed close to his chest so they couldn't put it. You know, when someone's going desperation, you've got to stay close to them, make sure they don't land that big punch, and I think I did it well.
You were able to recover after that round. Now we're looking at the 10th round, and you still had lots of strength. You were standing toe-to-toe and slugging it out with him.
10th round was more some blows, and if I would have fought every round like the 10th round, I would have won the fight big, but those are the breaks. I'm happy to be back home, and look forward to fighting again. It's a pleasure being here with you, too.
It's a pleasure being here with you. I'm glad you were so hospitable as to have us in here. Listen, let me ask you this. What would you do differently if you had this fight to fight over again? You obviously could go the distance. You had lots of strength in reserve there in the 10th round.
Well, the one thing that I'd do differently is that I would win.
That's short and to the point. We are going to do more with Jerry Cooney in just a couple minutes, but first we have to break away to do a little baseball. We do have a couple of local... Jerry Cooney, my question is now, where do you go from here? What do you do next, and when do you fight again?
Well, I'm just taking a little bit of time off to rest. I'm looking forward to getting back to the gym. I feel much more confident about myself. I feel like a real professional now. And I want to get back and get the proper training and to get in shape and look for a top contender to fight one or two before we fight for the title again. I'd like to fight for Larry Holmes for the title as soon as possible. And then I'd like to say it's been a pleasure being here with you tonight and look forward to seeing you.
It was just about a year ago that Boza Edwards was the WBC super featherweight champion. He held the title for 5 months in 1981. He won it from Rafael Bazooka Limon over 15 rounds back on March 8th. He had a successful defense, a war against Bobby Chacon right in this very same ring. And he took out Chacon in the 13th round. Then August 29th, 1981, he lost the title. And since then, he has won four in a row. All four by knockouts. Not one of his opponents has seen the sixth round. And he has also won the European Championship. And so Boza Edwards, at this point, the number one contender as far as super featherweights are concerned, is now about to take on lightweight Roberto Alexandro. Now, let's go back to August 29th, 1981, the night of infamy for Boza Edwards because he lost.